Well, praise the Lord, ladies and gentlemen. This is the day that the Lord has made, and I'm just so excited today. You know, God is so good, and you're looking and you're listening to Keeping It Real. We're here on the set with my co-host, Emmanuel Prince. How you doing, sir?
I'm good. I'm just keeping it real.
That's right. Oh, my God. This conference is just going so outstanding.
Outstanding ain't the word. It's just filled. It's touching. Women of love and preaching the mighty word of Jesus Christ.
Amen. Well, who's coming up next? I'm so excited. Who is that?
We have an extraordinary pastor.
Okay.
Rita Woodfin.
Yes, okay.
The founder and the CEO of Vision Keepers Ministry.
Woo!
She's a mother of three.
Okay.
She has. She's a grandmother of three. She's holy, she's sanctified
in
the Holy Spirit.
Come on.
Also, she delivers the word to the brokenhearted and the suffering through the words of Christ Jesus.
Ladies and gentlemen, fasten your spiritual seatbelts because the Holy Ghost is going to take off. Amen. Next, ladies and gentlemen, the woman of God, Pastor Rita Woodfin. Let's give the Lord a praise for her. Amen. What you send it to do in Jesus' name. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Now, if you would turn your Bibles to the book of Philemon, well, let's first go to the book of Luke 23, and we're going to be looking at verse 34 mainly. What I want to talk about today is something that is going on in this world that obviously society, as we know it, gives a little care about, and that is forgiveness.
Hallelujah.
Nobody's talking about forgiveness anymore. You know, we heard the message on how to minister and how to be ready to minister to the lost and bring souls to Christ. And then we heard the message about coming clean in 2014. But let me tell you something. Nothing is nothing unless you have a heart of forgiveness. Because that's how we all started off with Jesus.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
The Bible says when we confess our sins, that God is faithful and just to forgive us of all our sins. And then on top of that, to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That's called forgiveness.
Yeah.
Amen. That's called forgiveness. Now this morning, we want to talk about how it all got started. And if you remember in the book of Acts in chapter 2, and I think it's verse 38, where Peter had preached the gospel to the unbelievers and those that had persecuted Jesus and did all manner of evil toward him. And he told them in the gospel, he told them the truth of Jesus. And at the end of that, they said, then what must we do to be saved? And Jesus said, repent.
Hallelujah.
And be baptized in Jesus' name. Repent means to turn from what you're doing and turn to doing it a new way. A turn, not 360 degrees, but 180 degrees. If you turn 360 degrees, you're going to end up where you started.
Uh-oh.
Amen.
Amen.
Wow.
That's a full circle.
Wow.
You don't want to do that. You want to do the repent and be baptized in Jesus' name. And the Bible says in Romans 10 and 9 and 10, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. So confession is you talk to God about your sins. Forgive me for my sins. Forgive me for my wrongdoing and turn. But let me share something a little bit better with you this morning pertaining to forgiveness. Jesus wants us as his followers to pray and forgive our enemies. Pray for and forgive our enemies. On that cross at Calvary, Jesus uttered these words. He said, mighty word, able to heal, deliver, save, set free, and bring you into his beloved, then you can do this. Because Jesus did it. Yeah. Jesus was on that cross looking at his accusers, his murderers, and he sent a prayer up for them to the Father. Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. Uh-huh. They knew that they were crucifying him, yes, but they had no idea who he really, really was.
Amen.
He said, they don't know who I am. Yeah. Just like your persecutors.
Yeah. Right.
Those who offend you every day sometimes. Just like them. They don't really know who you are, but you gotta tell them who you are by what you do.
That's right.
And if you can live a life of forgiveness, that opens the door for many blessings. Because don't you even think that if you don't forgive your brother and your sister, that God is gonna forgive you. It's not gonna happen that way. It's not gonna happen that way. And the three principles of forgiveness, the three principles of forgiveness that we have to consider is, number one, forgive those who sin against us.
Yes.
That's a commandment of God.
Yes.
That's not a Rita commandment. That's God's word. Secondly, forgive so you can be forgiven.
Hallelujah.
That's God's word. Principle number three, if you don't forgive, you won't be forgiven. And guess what? If you're walking in unforgiveness, then you're out of fellowship with God.
Amen.
And you have no right at that point to ask anything of him. And in Proverbs chapter 19 and verse 11, it says, the discretion of a man makes him slow to anger. Don't be so fast to get angry. And his glory is to overlook a transgression. How many times have you been offended and you overlooked it? To overlook means to forgive. How many times have you been offended and you hold it in your heart forever? There are people in this room that are walking in unforgiveness. You don't have to tell me who you are. Holy Ghost is on the scene. He's working it out. So just listen to him and he'll take you out of that unforgiveness into forgiveness and put you back in right relationship and fellowship with God. So you can have open access to him. You can come to him boldly because you have come clean in 2014.
Come on,
Amen.
Yeah.
I'm going to use your word this morning. Because it's real like that. It's called keeping it real, right?
That's right.
Keeping it real? Let's keep it real. Don't you even think that God will be marked? He said he will not be marked in the book of Galatians. I think it's chapter 5. He says, don't be fooled. I will not be marked. That a man soweth, that he shall also reap. So if you're sowing unforgiveness, guess what? You're not forgiven. You're going to reap what we sow. Amen? So I'm admonishing and I'm encouraging, I'm advising, whether it's small or big, forgiveness is a necessary thing for the believer. We have to forgive. Some of us are hanging on to stuff that we say our parents did. And I know people standing in the pulpit hating their parents.
Ooh, help me, Jesus.
How crazy is that?
Right.
I know people asking God to heal their marriage and they can't stand their mate. How crazy is that? You want God to supersede your heart. And he's not going to do that. It's in his word. To forgive completely requires one of the most difficult of all adjustments, but Jesus described it so simply. Just forgive. And it shall be forgiven you. You shall be forgiven. In Matthew chapter 6 and verse 14, it tells us that if we don't forgive, we will not be forgiven. So we don't need to climb the mountain to heaven to ask God if we've been forgiven. You will know it in your heart. If you've forgiven a man or if you have been forgiven. Amen? Let me put these glasses on. How many minutes do I have? I'm going to have to run through this. Amen. 5 minutes. Okay. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Now, we look in the book of Philemon. Let's look over there real quick. And we're going to look at where Paul is encouraging Philemon to forgive Onesimus. Now, some people look at this book as one thing, but I look at it as a book of forgiveness. And Paul wrote to him in verses 8 through 18, he says, therefore, although in Christ I could be bold and order you to do what you ought to do. In other words, Paul says, I've been in the Lord and I've been teaching you and watching you how you have church in your house. I can order you to forgive Onesimus and take it back. He said, but I want to appeal to you on the basis of my love for you. Amen? So when we have love for a person, you can appeal to Jesus to help you forgive that person, to give you a heart to forgive. And he went on to say, it is as none other than Paul, an old man and now also a prisoner of Christ Jesus, that I appeal to you for my own son Onesimus, who became my son while I was in prison. While Paul was in prison, Onesimus was one of the persons that went to visit him, and he was converted through the word that Paul delivered to him while he was in prison. Paul was in prison, yet teaching people how to be saved and sending them back for forgiveness. Amen. Give the Lord a hand praise on that. Amen. Some of us walking around every day ain't teaching nobody nothing and not forgiving nobody anything. He tells Philemon that Onesimus was useless to you before, but now he has become useful to both you and me. Why is he useful now? Because he has been forgiven, and he's ready to go and be forgiven. And it is expected of the servant of the Lord, Philemon, to forgive him and take him back into a right relationship as brother to brother, not as servant and master and slave, but now as a friend, as a brother in Christ. This is how we're to live this thing. We have to live a life of forgiveness or we can forget it.
Well,
you're not fooling God, and I want you to know something, you're not fooling the person that you have not forgiven. Forgive people.
Yes.
That's the new deal.
Yes.
Yeah, we can come clean. We can minister. Forgive. That's the new deal of the day.
Yes.
Amen. It's behind door number one.
Yes.
Woo! When you pull the curtains back, just say, I forgive.
Hallelujah.
I forgive you. Practice it.
Yes.
Teach it to your children. It is vital to your relationship with the Lord. We must walk in forgiveness. I'm going to teach forgiveness until it gets in there.
Hey.
Everywhere I go, I'm talking about it. God won't let me up from it. Forgive. What's going on in you? So-and-so and so won't do this. Won't they? Talking about your pastor. Shut it up and shut it down. Forgive.
Jesus.
Hallelujah. Because God is on the throne and he is yet watching. And he's moving by the counsel of his own will, not ours.
Jesus.
Our tears don't move God.
Yes.
You know what moves God? Our obedience to his word.
Hallelujah.
When you obey God,
that's right.
Leave the consequences to him.
That's right.
I hear Charles Stanley say that all the time, and I ride on that. God, this is an ugly deal right here that's been dealt me, but I'm going to forgive them, and I'll leave the consequences to you.
Amen.
What you do with this is up to you, God.
Yes.
I got this two words that I say frequently. You see.
You see. That's right.
You see.
Yeah.
I don't have to say nothing else.
That's right.
Because it's all before him.
That's right.
I forgive you. I've had some people do some stuff to me that was in the mind that the natural carnal mind of man is unforgivable.
I know.
But Jesus said on that cross, after they accused him, after they put the thorns in his head, after they whipped him, after they lied on him, after they persecuted him, after they put the nails in his hand and in his feet, after they waited for him to die on that cross, a blameless man, from his heaven, walked on this earth to show us the way, he died on that cross. But in his breath, deteriorating from him, which he gave up, by the way, he said, Father.
Yes.
Father.
Amen.
Father. He talked to God because he was no longer in the earthly realm to move in his own capacity. He has now been raised up. He had been raised up to the cross. So now he had to deliver his prayer to the Father. So he prayed for his enemies. He didn't just pray for them. He said, forgive them.
Yes.
Amen.
Forgive them. So who are we? Jesus brought us out. He died for us that we may be able to come out of the muck and the mire and live a life of righteousness and holiness in Christ Jesus. Then who are forgive.
Right. Amen.
He has the power that he put in us through his Holy Spirit that we can do all things through Christ. I say, because he is our strength.
Hallelujah.
Because he is our strength. So I encourage you today to look up when times get rough, that Father, whatever has been done to you by whomever, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Do it in the name of Jesus and watch the transformation in your life and the life of those around you. Father, we thank you today. We give you praise, we give you glory, we give you honor for your word, God. Help us to obey your word and walk in it according to your ordinances and your instructions. In Jesus' name, help us to walk in total forgiveness. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Give God some praise. Hallelujah.
Stepping out on faith.
Come on, let's get stepping out on faith. Some glory. Give the Lord a miracle out here in the
street.
That's what I'm talking.
She's a happy, beautiful mother of four grown kids.
Okay.
And she has a development, a transitional for the disabled. And she definitely wants you to believe and see in it and walk in it.
Amen. And you know, her church is a children's church. You know how you have an adult church? Well, she has a church, and there's nothing in there but children.
You've been adults.
That's what I'm talking
training
about.
Training them up.
That's right. So next, ladies and gentlemen, we have Dr. Melvora Moore Fulton.
Praise God, and I thank God for another opportunity to be here in this house, in this conference for 2014. Lord Jesus, I thank you for the words that will proceed out of my mouth, Lord Jesus, that it will be a blessing to the hearer as well as myself, Lord Jesus. I thank you for this conference, Lord, that it's not just another conference, Lord, but a conference of learning and growing in you, Lord. We thank you for each and every one. We thank you for the head of this house.
Yes.
In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Give God a hand, praise. I thank you, praise God, for another year. This is the year 2014, saints. And you know, as I was preparing for this, you know, as I tell myself and would advise other ministers, you get before God on what it is that he would want you to say, because you have to move flesh out of the way and allow God's word to flow through you. So the subject that God has given me for this Keeping It Real conference is that you have a purpose. That this is 2014 and you have a purpose. So I'm gonna give you some points, and if you would like to, write them down. because it may be some meat for you for the remainder of this year. Because sometimes we get so caught up in going to church and reading the Bible that we don't set a specific course of action. And I thank God that this year I said, Lord, I thank you for allowing me to be in ministry these past 6 years. I thank you, Lord Jesus, for the children. And a lot of people look at me and say, a ministry for children. And I say, we accept adults too, because you know, it's many parents that need to hear the word. But one thing he let me know when he gave me the mandate for the children is that we need to train them up. And a lot of times in the homes they're coming from, they're not being trained. You have young mothers who were not trained. So therefore, they're producing a whole generation of young kids who don't know anything about church etiquette. So this year, he gave me, I want to change the flow. I want to change the purpose of how I'm going to reach masses of young people for him. And you know, as we go out and witness for adults to come into our fellowships, we are forgetting the most crucial element of all of his people, and that's his children. So I always know that if you go after that child and witness for that child, he will fill up a church. Because as the children come, they will go home and start telling their parents what they're learning in church. And maybe that parent wasn't brought up in church, maybe don't know anything about church, but baby, let them babies keep going home telling them about what they're learning in church. Sooner or later, those parents are gonna get an itching ear. And you know, before God even called me to this over 30 years ago, I started this and didn't even know what I was starting. That's why you have to walk in what God calls for you. I was a teacher in Illinois, and one Thanksgiving I mentioned to my children that I go to church on Thanksgiving. 4 children walked up to me and said, can we go to church with you? And I said, can you go to church with me? I said, but I need your parents' permission. In those days, it was no cell phone. So I called the parents and they said, sure. That's Thursday of Thanksgiving morning, I picked the children up. They went to church with me. That next week at school, I had over 30 kids walking into my classroom asking if they could go to church with me. Before I left Illinois in 1982, over hundreds of children had came. 40 had accepted Christ in their life. Parents had started coming to church. My pastor prophesied and told me, one day you will fill up a building full of children. You know, when I got that word some 30 years ago, I didn't know how God was going to manifest that word, but he did manifest that word. So as he gives us our purpose, people, we got to go after what God has given us. So introduction one is, what you do matters to God. There is a purpose for your life. What you do, there is a purpose for your life. Many people say, but I don't know my purpose. Then you haven't really truly seen the word of God. Number two, God, you are created to know God. You are created to know God. One purpose in life is to get close to God, and you can do this through Jesus Christ. And then I wanted to let you know that you were created, and you were created, and it wasn't an accident. God knew when he created you. And when you think about our lives when we were children growing up in our families, we had no inkling on what we were going to do or be. But God did. God already knew what he created you for. And God has the most wonderful plan for your life. The next point is, you are created for God's glory.
Amen.
One purpose in life is to glorify God in this world. And the way we glorify God in this world is to be obedient. And I love hearing what the pastor said. It's about our obedience. It's about our faith. And it's about us forgiving. And when I sat there and listened to all of their key points, I said, that is what God wants us to hear for this year. And then the next point is, you are created to praise God.
Yes.
You are created to praise God. So when you go to church on Sunday morning, you don't have to wait for that praise leader to get up and start singing. You're supposed to come in that door with a praise in your heart. And if the praise is not going the way it's supposed to, you just get up and add to it and start praying and speaking in tongues and watch that atmosphere change. And you know, when the children come in, I say, you leave that foolishness at the door, because we're getting ready to praise God. And you know, I want them to be able to praise God in such a way that they will feel the presence of the Holy Ghost in them and in that service. So therefore, another point five, you are created to grow the fruit of the Spirit. You are created. When you see somebody down, go to them and talk to them. When you see somebody that's not walking the path you think they should go, walk and talk and pray with them. You know, we've been on our block for the past 6 years. And you know, the people in a neighborhood, I learned something. You could pass out hundreds of flyers every weekend to invite people to come to your church. They may not come that first Sunday. They may not come the first month, second month, or even a year. But as long as you're in that community doing what God has called you to do, sooner or later, you're going to see the fruit of your labor. You're going to have them walking in telling you, you know, I had a lady just 2 Sundays ago, Latino lady. And she came to me and her children came the first couple of Sundays when we opened. And I've been talking and seeing her children for the past 6 years. And she came in at the end of our holiday program and she said, Pastor, I want you to pray for me. She said, I'm going through something. I may have stage 2 cancer, but I really don't know what to do. She said, I don't go to church because she said, I don't trust half of them folks in the church. She said, but I've been watching you. I've been watching you. And I see you as a woman of integrity. I see you as a woman that has a caring heart. See, sometimes God will bring in folk who you think not even paying you any attention. See, it's not about your title. It's not about who you think you are. It's only about what you are doing for the kingdom. And God said that he will bring in people to help you. Sometimes we struggle so much to have people listen to us and we want people to love us. We want people to share with us. But God just said, do what I told you to do. Stop worrying about what everybody else is doing. Just do what I have called you to do. So in this year, 2014, it is your purpose to do well. It is your purpose to be blessed. It is your purpose for your dreams to come true. And see, the thing about dreams coming true and vision coming through, what are you doing for God? What are you doing? You're still doing the same old thing you did in 2013. Get on up. Change that situation. So therefore, the fruit that you have, the fruit that you bear is important. You are created to spread the gospel.
Hallelujah.
Don't be afraid to spread the gospel. Some people on your job don't even know you saved. Some people on your job don't even know you could get a prayer through. Some people in your neighborhood don't even know you go to nobody's church by what they see going in and out of your house or in and out of your apartment or the language that you're saying. That they need to know beyond a shadow of a doubt that when I'm in trouble, if nobody else on this block can help me, Mary across the street, I know she can get a prayer through. You are created to use the talents that God gave you. You are created to use the talents. Let me go over that one again. Because a lot of people think if you're not standing behind this podium, if you don't have the best voice in the world, if you don't earth your all standing up straight and can walk down that aisle and get that money in the offering time, they think they have nothing to contribute. But it's your talents. Work the talent that God gave you.
Hallelujah.
Work that talent. Don't worry about if you're a little bit off key. Are you singing to the glory of God? Are you saying, Lord, this is my voice that you gave me and I'm giving it back to you? Lord, I may not can help around in the office, but I sure do know how to clean a carpet
That's real good.
I know how to clean a bathroom real good. I know how to drive the bus to the best of my ability. Use your talents for God's glory. And then as you're created to use those talents, one purpose in life is to develop your gifts. Now, if you have the gift of speaking and you feel you cannot speak, then it's classes you can take. It's people that you can study up under that will give you pointers. Live life as an adventure wherever you are. Live life as an adventure. See, we want God to bless us. And this year, God has given me some great visions. See, I go to bed at night and I say, Lord, what do you want of me? How do you want me to train up these children? How do you want me to impact my community? And you know, God's simple little answer is just be yourself.
Hallelujah.
Be yourself. See, some people you hear, they speak so well, so elegantly. And I used to say, Lord, I've been teaching a long time, but I'm just plain me. And God said, I want you to teach people just like you do in your classroom. I want you to teach it where as simple as a child can get it.
Hallelujah.
And when you teach it as simple as a child can get it, everybody don't understand the $25 words. Everybody don't understand all the dictionary definitions. But when you reach somebody from their heart, when you reach somebody to their heart and from their heart, they're going to receive that word. So you can be educated. Oh, you can be educated. But you, as my grandmother always said, you can be an educated fool. Because you'll be so high up here that you don't know how to reach even the simplest of a person. So therefore, the gifts and the talents that God cultivates in you. Saints, this is a new year. You should have a journal somewhere where you have written down what you expect to see God do for you in this 2014 season. Now you may say, but I don't know how it would be manifest. It's not about how you think it should be manifest. It's about God's purpose for your life. I know I'm stepping out this year to do some things that in my flesh, in me, would say it's impossible. But see, your dream is supposed to be so big that it's not for you to figure out how it's going to work out. It's for God, because he done already put it in your belly. He done already told you to do it, so you got to walk by faith and do it. And I say, Lord, I never let money stop me. I know I just say, Lord, I don't have it, but didn't you tell me the cattle of 1,000 hills, it all belongs to you. See, you got the purpose in your heart. You got to know that your purpose and your desire is what God wants for you. See, he wants us to reach so many people for him. And my year desire, you know, I want to go into developmentally disabled young people and adults, because, see, folks have locked these people away thinking they can't do anything.
Exactly.
They treat them like they can't do nothing but get up in the morning, put their clothes on, go to a day center, and come home. See, but what I want to do is so unique and different. I want to show the world that if you present Jesus to them, if you just present Jesus to them, it's going to change their life. Because see, even a person with autism, a person with Down syndrome, they know how to say, thank you, Jesus. They know how to say thank you, Jesus. And sometimes, and then when I went through the trainings, they've told me you can't force church on anybody or religion. Oh, I'm not going to force it, but it's going to be 24/7. They got not going to do nothing but want to know we going with you on Sunday morning. So therefore, you have to walk after. You got the purpose in your heart that you are about serving God. So in this conference, keeping it real, I just want to drop those thoughts on you. Make your 2014 better than you ever could have imagined, because you can either think this way. 2014 is going to be all that God wants it to be. Or 2014, you just saying, I'm ready to go on home because I'm not doing nothing. So you don't never stop working. You never stop dreaming. I don't care if you don't have the best job you don't have now. Work on it. See, if you don't have the education you need for that job, go get it. If you say, I just can't pray like Mary, go study. And God will give you everything that you think you will need. See, the thing of purpose and destiny. And then the last scripture I want to leave with you is found in Jeremiah 29:11-13.
Hallelujah.
For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans for welfare and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope. Then you will call upon me, come and pray to me, and I will hear you. And verse 13 says, you will seek me and find me. And when you seek me with all your heart. Now them three scriptures are so crucial. It's because he already know the plans he has for you. And I read that from the English Standard Version. He knows what he's going to do in your life. Stop doubting him. Stop saying it cannot happen. God loves you so, so much, saints. And may your 2014 be better than you could ever imagine. And I thank God for his word. And Lord, I thank you for the people who will view this tape, Lord, that Lord, Lord, if they're not saved and don't have a place to go worship and seek you, Lord Jesus, that you will lead them to a place where they will be fed, they will be nourished, and where they will grow. And for those of those who think they got it all together, Lord, take them back to that place. Yes. Take them back to a place where they can reconnect with you. Yes. Take them back to that first love that they said they had for you, Lord Jesus. And Lord, put them on fire even more. Let them know that it's not about nothing they can do, but only to your glory and your honor. In Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Jesus. Let everybody say, in Jesus' name. Amen. And God bless.
Praise the Lord, everybody. This is a time where everybody can be a part of this service. It's now seed time and harvest. And SOB is a nonprofit, 501c3 nonprofit organization. And you can plant your seed in this ministry and know that you're planting in good ground, which is a 501c nonprofit organization. When you plant your seed in SOB, you're planting it in good ground. And your donations are greatly accepted here. In Jesus' name, if you look on the bottom of the screen, our address is there, so you can send your donations in. Getting ready to pray for our seed right now. And Father God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for every seed that's planted in this ministry, God. Bless the giver, God. Bless those that can't give. In the name of Jesus, we pray and we thank you. Amen.
Oh, praise the Lord, ladies and gentlemen. There you have it. Keeping it real, you two ladies. I just want to thank you for being on the broadcast. It was just simply outstanding. And before we go, you may be out there with a sickness or a disease in Jesus' name. You may be out there and you don't know Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. The number's on the screen right now. And I just want you to know you can notify us. If you are interested in any of the speakers that are in our series of Keeping It Real, let us know. We'll contact them. You can have them at your churches and your schools, etc. So right now, we just want to stand and believe God for a miracle right now in Jesus' name. And let's just stretch our hand and everybody in the studio right now, just believe God. There's no accident that you tuned to this television broadcast right now. And in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, we call in.
Be okay. And every single day I